Hi, in this video you will learn about ways in which urban society interacts with urban services to address climate change. Measures that are being taken for climate adaptation or mitigation put the existing centralized urban infrastructures for water, energy or food supply under pressure. They are changing the urban fabric. The larger systems do not disappear as many of these larger systems become connected to smaller systems. Others do split up and decentralize. We can talk about urban splintering in this respect. Examples are, for instance, urban agriculture to supply fresh food or to process organic waste, constructed wetlands as an alternative form of urban wastewater treatment, or the development of microgrids next to central electricity supply. Apart from these physical changes in systems, we also see various alternative forms of governance emerging. As public utilities used to manage the central systems, backed up by central governments, it does not mean that the decentralized systems are also managed like that. We see public-private partnerships in which local authorities work together with private firms to provide decentralized services. Communities or neighborhoods who are managing local energy generation, urban agriculture, or community toilets. These developments show the need to move away from the classical dichotomy in service provision, briefly that of small versus large provision. Since the first wave of environmental consciousness in the 1960s, one discourse has emphasized that small-scale devices such as composting toilets or solar cookers would be viable alternatives to the polluting modern energy, water and food systems. Small is beautiful, as Schumacher told us in 1973. On the other hand, there is the point of view claiming that both climate and efficiency gains can be reached by using economies of scale. Large systems can rationally be controlled and managed. Rational both from a climate change and an economic point of view. This, for instance, is a typical example of thinking big in sustainable energy infrastructures. A supergrid connecting renewable energy generators stretching over more than one continent. When evaluating newly emerging initiatives in the urban context, the dichotomy between small and large just doesn't work for the assessment of current urban splintering. The examples of current measures for climate mitigation and adaptation seem to sit between the small and the large. Let me take the example of sanitation to explain the thinking in social and technical scales. For long, the discussion has been whether we should have big sewer systems, water flush toilets, huge wastewater plants for urban sanitation worldwide, or that we should downscale these systems, that is making smaller, easier to manage systems. Important to note here is that the small versus large discussion is not only about technical skills. Somehow, big is associated with grey and industrial, while small is considered green, organic, natural. Big systems are considered big in terms of technical skills, but also, at the same time, in management, combining the flows that are treated, and with low levels of involvement of users. Small systems are associated with high involvement of users, separated flows, and decentralized management. So large scale means often big works, centralized management, while small scale refers to small technologies and small organization as well. This division in small and large is a simplification. Not only do you miss valuable levels between the large and the small, you also miss the social and managerial dimensions of scale. The emerging urban systems that are put in place to mitigate or adapt to climate change do certainly not fit in the simple large versus small dichotomies. Some big systems can be entirely supported by the active involvement of many users. An example is a wind park set up by motivated consumer shareholders. And many small systems can be managed by big actors. For instance, in case of centrally controlled heat power units, distributed over many households. Community energy organizations for solar energy show an intermediate level of organization, while their systems can still be connected to the central electricity grids. And big water companies support intermediate level water treatment sites because they are a valuable addition to the performance of the water system at large. At the same time, these systems require the involvement and management of householders who are discharging their wastewater to the system. Such community co-provision of urban services may be a renewed phenomenon in the Western context. It is not in the Global South. Communities are responsible for drinking water services, sanitation or waste management, sometimes on their own in the absence of formal public services, sometimes in collaboration with formal, private and public service providers. An abstract representation of my message would look like this. Diverse blue or yellow small systems work together with the larger red and green systems, and they are interconnected via grids, like power lines, for instance. Many climate change adaptation and mitigation measures come in intermediate scales of urban service provision, skills that have until recently been overlooked if one has an eye for the big versus the small systems only. New combinations between utility providers, businesses, communities and individual co-producers are on the increase. The social and technical diversity it delivers present opportunities for urban climate adaptation beyond the small versus large debate in service provision. How would you evaluate the service provision in your cities related to climate change? Do you indeed observe the social and technical diversity in the measures taken? And what about the skills of infrastructure, of management, of citizens' involvement in your city?